Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Hey, Steve, we're back and we are in, is this part four of God's Design for Family?
Yes, sir.
All right.
I don't know if we have enough to fill the whole thing, but maybe we could, you know, we can talk about the Stanley Cup. You know, my Penguins won last night or something like that. Okay, I think we
That's hockey, right?
I'm not usually a big hockey fan, but I did grow up in Pittsburgh, and so I'm a Pittsburgh fan. You'll find out that if you live in Pittsburgh, you're not only a Steeler fan, you're a Pirate fan, and you're a Penguins fan. So, okay, so this one, we just finished talking about John 15:9, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. And that was, to me, what that was saying is, yes, it's important for families that you love your children, teach your children, raise them to live forever. All the kind of stuff that we generally think about as parents, we don't think about ourselves. But what I felt God's been directing me the last few years is he's not only working with the people that are being taught, he's working with the teacher, and that's the parent. And you can't replace mom and dad. And so the interesting part of this is Jesus was loved perfectly for 30 years. I don't think that 30 years was wasted. I think every minute was forming and equipping and molding Jesus with his mom and dad in Nazareth and living at home until he's 30 years old and going to the temple every feast and going to synagogue once a week and all those years, which was had to be somewhat chafing to him because he was so far advanced of everybody he knew. I mean, he knew the Bible. He knew God. He was loved by his dad. And yet he's still living at home and still working with his father's business and still saying yes, ma'am, to his mother who's making him make wine at weddings and stuff. So when you think about it, I don't know about you, but I get a few skills and I'm ready to go. And Jesus, 30 years. Loved by his dad, as the Father has loved me. Then, after he had all this wonderful training, then, a couple years, he completely fulfills his earthly ministry. He hangs on the cross. He breaks the power of hell. He despoils death. He takes our sin. He opens heaven's doors for us. I mean, it's amazing. All the things happen on the cross. But Jesus, he was prepared for that because he'd spent these 30 years. Now, guess what? Scott and Steve are both dads. We're both husbands. How many years did we spend preparing to be a husband? How many years did we spend preparing to be a dad? Right? Mm-hmm. I think being a husband and a father is our greatest calling for which we're the least equipped and the least trained, and which has the most far-reaching implications. And so, obviously, God's design for us is that we learn on the job. And so, being a dad is what drove me to the scripture to find out how to be a dad, and then that drove me to God because it says if you want to be a great dad, you got to love me with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love my word, and then you can teach your kids to love me and love my word. And I thought, yeah, that makes sense. So it turns out that being a husband and a dad has revealed my own needs and has sent me to my knees and sent me to God's word and sent me to God himself, which is ultimately the goal of anything, is that we know God and love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. So, okay, so having said all this, you might say Jesus had the perfect training and he had a perfect ministry because he was perfectly trained. But you and I can't stop 10 years into our marriage and got a couple kids and say, oh man, I think I need to go take a class in marriage for 5 years in the wilderness. And now I need another 5 years on being a husband. I mean, being a dad. That's not God's plan. So God's plan is that we learn on the job. So what I'm starting to see more and more in scripture is that there's a couple things going on. I first can never forget the fact that I am a child myself. And the best thing I can do is every day draw near to my dad and spend time in His presence and spend time in His Word and spend time in prayer and be rooted and grounded in God's love. And then I'll be equipped to love my wife as I've been loved, to love my sons as I've been loved, because the more I'm loved, the more I can love. I can't give what I haven't received. So here's what Jesus said: as I have loved you, love one another. And so now this last little episode here on this four-part series, we're going to talk about that. So Father, once again, direct us, give us understanding where we need it, give us anointing where we need it, and reveal yourself through the whole process. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So that seems to me to be God's design. So like Jesus, the Son of God, we want to be rooted and grounded in God's love. But then, as we have been loved, then we to love our kids. So, point number one, if we were to follow the same design how Jesus was loved, and now we are not the kids, but now we're the parents, then we should love our children as we have been loved. We've been told that we're children of God. We've been told that we're loved. We've been told that we're well-pleasing, and we've been filled with the Spirit. And now I think it's real important that we do the same thing for our kids. So one of the things that we need to, point number one, very pragmatic, make sure that we're happy that those kids are our kids, and make sure that they know that we think we're so thrilled that God put you into our family and that you are a Demi, or that if your situation, you're a more. And each of those more children knows that, hey, that's who I am. I belong to the more family. I've got a mom and a dad who love me and think I'm the best thing since sliced bread. And then for me, I want my sons to know not only are you Demis, but you are loved and you are liked. And we've talked about some of these things that we've done in our home on their birthdays, sending them cards, honoring them, playing categories, some of these specifics. But whatever we can do to make sure that our children not only know that they belong, that they are children, but that they are loved, not just endured. Of course, there's days that we endure them, but bottom line is we want them to know that when all said and done, we still think they are special for who they are, not based on how they act or what they do or what they accomplish, but it's called unconditional love. And we want them to know that they're well-pleasing. Sure, they can do things better, but we like them just the way they are. We think they're special because they're our kid and because we love them. And then we want to encourage them to be filled with the Spirit and develop their own relationship with God, because this is, God doesn't, you know, God's limited. God doesn't have grandchildren. And I could say, I have something God doesn't have. I have grandchildren. But God only has children, and each of our kids has to develop their own relationship with God and be adopted, loved, well-pleasing, have that sensing from Him too. And that's our job. So that's really it. And that's what I'm trying to do more and more. You know, I've tried for years to make my kids know that they're loved. I've tried to make them know that they belong. I've tried to encourage them in their spiritual walk. But what I felt like God has taken me up a notch in this last several years is deepen your own relationship with God. Best thing I can do is crawl up into my dad's lap every morning, get a big hug, be affirmed by His Word, ask Him for a soft heart, ask Him to fill me with my Spirit. Then my good intentions will have some real meat to them, because it's one thing to want your kids to get this stuff, but again, it's hard to give them something that you haven't experienced and tasted yourself. So this is, I feel like every minute that I spend seeking God, seeking His Word, taking my walks in the evening, just letting my dad love on me, affirm me, communicate with me, developing my relationship with God is the best thing I can do to be a godly husband and a father. And Peter puts it this way beautifully, 2 Peter 3:18, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So it can't be static. It's got to be an ongoing relationship. And we need to continue to deepen our walk and be more rooted and grounded in love. Now, if we can do this, we're going to find out that lo and behold, one of the beauties of this family dynamic is that we will be changed. And I get this from Enoch, Genesis 5:22. It says, Enoch walked with God after he fathered Methuselah. So discipling our children and seeking to be a good husband and a dad drives us to God, drives us to deepen our relationship, and transforms us in the process. And that's one of the beauties of the family. You know, I've heard Christian leaders lament and moan on the shallowness of the average Christian nowadays, or there's not a lot of deep discipleship. And so in a typical American fashion, we think we need to have people get degrees and how to disciple people in the church. And then we have discipling ministries and we create more curriculum to be discipled. And I believe one of the best things you can do to be deepen your relationship with God is be a dad. Get married. You're going to find out you don't know very much and you're more selfish than you ever dreamed until you get married. And then when you have children and all of a sudden you realize that these little kids are looking to you to teach them about eternal life and teach them about God. And it's not up to you to take them to some expert. It's up to you to do it. And when you do it, you find out what you don't know. It drives you to your knees. It's a good thing.
Well, and the living illustration of how the Father feels about us. I mean, when you look at your little boy who's just, you'd lay down your life for him. I mean, I've learned more about how God feels about me from having kids. When I first held my daughter and my oldest, you know, when she was just a baby, I'm like, wow, is this how you feel about me, God? Because I had no idea. And it also helped me figure out how my parents had felt about me too, which was a whole different level of thinking. But that's a living parable right there for you.
Totally. And having some little guy come up and just climb onto your lap and say, Daddy, and wrap his arms around your neck. Yeah.
Yeah.
But you know what's interesting about this? Again, it's new information for me is I was always focused on being a loving dad and I wanted to love my kids and all that. But I had trouble receiving love. Still do. I somehow think that I have to do something to receive. So if I do something for my family or if I do something for somebody and then they say thank you, then I smile and I've kind of earned it. And it wasn't the earning fact. It's hard for me to believe that people like me for just being me. But that's how our kids like us. We're just their dad, you know, and that's how. It's just hard, this whole idea of when you really know somebody and you still love them, that's hard for me to grasp. And that's one of the areas that I continue to work on is believing Psalm 139, that God knows me. And as my last newsletter said, the one who knows me best loves me most. Whew. But when I start taking that in, I think I'm much more equipped then to let other people know the same thing, that I just love them for who they are and not for what they do. So accepting, receiving unconditional love prepares us to give unconditionally. Mm-hmm. At least that's where I am so far in my journey. Now, maybe in 5 years, if we're still doing podcasts, that'll be episode 299. We'll take it up a notch. But this is what I think God's plan is. I really believe in John 15:9-12. You get the whole unveiling of this. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. And then he says, and as I have loved you, love each other. There it is. And then in John 13:35 says, and by this shall all men know that you are my disciples if you love one another as I have loved you. If we can love each other as we have been loved, which starts with first being loved, then we will not only change ourselves and be transformed into his image and become more like Christ. Not only will we know God better, but the whole world will know that we're his disciples because of our love. That will be the That will be the thing that will turn people to Christ, is seeing how we love each other.
On that, when you were talking before about the about God, the Father saying, "This is my Son, my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." Like, that's the bedrock, core basis for every one of us for our whole life, is we need to know we are His beloved son and daughter. We need to know that in our hearts, and our children need to know that from us. You know, like, if they don't have that, nothing else matters. They don't care what we want to teach them if they don't know that they're beloved to us.
Yep. So what do you think? Do you really think that God looks at us in Christ and says, "Scott, Steve, you are my beloved son in whom I am well pleased"?
Yes, I've believed that for a long time. I'm starting to feel it.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. So we know it in our head, but we're starting to get it down into our core of our being.
Down into your gizzard.
Yep.
It's deeper than your heart.
Well,
you gotta feel it in your gizzard, man, to really know it.
Okay. So now we have to change that song. I've got the love of God down in my gizzard.
That's right.
Down in my gizzard. Down in my gizzard. Okay. Well, I just wrote this up, maybe to wrap this up a little bit. I wrote this, that when you know down in your gizzard, when you are rooted and grounded in the love of God, and you know that you've been accepted, liked, loved, well-pleasing. I don't want to keep using the same words so we get tired of hearing them. But what it does is it frees us up. And here I made a list of things just to help. Because if we had started off with this and said, "Would you like to have these things?" I think most people would say yes. But the secret to having these things is to be rooted, grounded in God's love. But here they are. Number one, you are free to be real, be honest, be loved. You can have personal boundaries, number two, which enable empathy, and you won't be so defensive. Number three, you can enjoy God without being obsessed to work to be accepted or well-pleasing. And there's a fine line there, but there's a difference. Number five, you can create a safe home. Number six, and this is under the area of communication, you can have open, honest, safe communication without reacting emotionally. Number seven, you can fully listen with all your attention focused on the speaker without having any defenses up. Number eight, children will be able to address difficult topics and parents will be able to hear. And the last one, you can speak without needing to be affirmed or feeling a need to convince. You can just speak. And I feel like that my communication improves, my personal relationship with each of my family members improves the more that I am foundationally rooted and grounded in God's love. My relationship with my dad totally informs and impacts all of my relationships with those that are closest to me. And if we have healthy families, we'll have healthy churches. And if we have healthy families and healthy churches, we're going to have a healthy world. What we're doing here in learning to develop our own relationship with God has far-reaching implications. And if Jesus could spend, let's do the ratio. Let's say that he ministered for 3 years, but he spent 30 years in preparation. What is that? Yeah. Most of his time was spent developing his relationship. His actual ministry was a small portion. So I think we need to switch it around, because I know that having been in ministry for most of my Christian life, I spend more time ministering than I do being ministered to by my dad. But I think if I was to spend more time with my dad, I'd have had a better ministry up to this point. So that's what I'm seeking to do, is invest in that ministry of loving and being loved with my dad. And then when I do have something to say or someone to talk to or someone to pray for, I'll have something more beneficial.
Is that what all that sabbatical stuff is about with professional Christian ministers? When they go on sabbatical, that's supposed to be their time where they're getting loved by God so they can be restored.
I don't know, but...
Well, I mean, that 10-to-1 ratio, that'd be a pretty good gig, man. 10 years on sabbatical for 1 year doing ministry. I like that.
Well, I remember, I don't know if you, you know, early on in your Christian life, things stick differently. And I remember somebody saying that Martin Luther used to spend 2 hours a day with God before he did anything else. But if he had a really busy day and really important things to do, he spent 4 hours. Mm. And I never forgot that. And I used to think, what? Yeah. I only have 10 minutes. I got things to do. I got to study. I got to do stuff. I got to help people. The world's falling apart. The world needs me. They need the gospel. I can't be spending time with my, you know, just on my knees reading and meditating. And of course, at that point, I didn't enjoy God like I do.
Right.
Because I haven't had the joy of jamming. I have to explain that. However, I do enjoy taking my walks in the evening with my dad. Probably as much as anything I do right now, that's my greatest joy. And that hasn't been the case until the last couple of years. Yeah. So, Father, help us to enjoy you and rest in you and wait on you and taste of you, and help us to develop a taste for your presence and your person. Give us an appetite. And don't let us try to falsely quench that thirst that's deep down inside of each one of us, where we hunger and thirst for you and for your presence and your righteousness and your being. And save us from trying to fulfill that with earthly things. You know, I got my own stuff. It's not a guitar for me, but there's other things that I try to fill that space with, that void. Help us to drink of only you, in Jesus' name. Amen.
I love that lady's response and the woman at the well. And she says, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." Yeah. And I mean, I breeze over these things. I've read them so many times and I'm like, man, when was the last time you felt thirsty for time with Jesus? Or when was the last time you really felt thirsty for like that? Like, I mean, that kind of craving when you're really thirsty and you just got to guzzle a bottle full of water and it feels so refreshing. When was the last time you felt that thirst for time with him? And I was like, holy cow, I've spent years not being thirsty because I've been drinking some lame excuse for his living water, you know?
I totally love what you're saying. Yeah, because you're speaking to my heart, and I'm trying to remember, there's a song that says something like, "Let me drink of only thee." And yeah, but you know, that's the same thing Psalm 42 says, "As the deer pants for the water brooks, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God." So may God give us a thirst but at the same time, we do have ways of, we think we're quenching that thirst with other stuff, but I think that thirst was divinely put into our hearts that we would only thirst for him. So, amen. Hey, by the way, in Revelation, it says, now I'm searching this on my computer, it says, they will neither thirst anymore, because the Lamb will be the center of the throne, will be their shepherd. So someday we're going to drink freely and fully, but we can start now. Amen.
And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. If you have a question for the show, email steve@spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.